G'day, Chris here, and welcome back to Clickspring. In addition to the two node display assemblies made in the previous episode, there are six other wheel assemblies that make up the calculation train. But before I complete them, I'd like to give you a bit more detail on the Arbor design that I briefly introduced in that video. The few parts that remain of the original artifact indicate a very distinctive Arbor design that ensured a good mechanical connection between the components of each assembly without requiring any solder. Square arbors were threaded into square holes, and the arbor ends were thoroughly peened to hold the assemblies in place. It's a very solid way to do things, and I followed this precedent to some extent when I built the prototype. This approach remains open to you if you prefer it, but it does come with a few drawbacks, not the least of which being that it's a lot of extra work to implement. Not just in forming all of the arbors into accurate squares, but also either filing or making a set of broaches to open up accurate square holes in each of the wheels and pinions. So I've specified a much more straightforward approach for this modern interpretation of the machine. Round shafts in round holes, bonded with either soft solder or, if you prefer, one of the modern adhesives. Mechanically, this approach is enough to meet the small loads experienced in the machine. And aside from making it easy to construct, as I mentioned in the previous video, it also makes depthing more convenient too. An additional benefit is that it also allows for a much less destructive disassembly, should that be required at some point in the future. Each of the arbors was formed on the lathe, and then given a light polish to bring up the surface finish. Now the input arbor requires particular attention, because it has some features that make it a little awkward to hold. No matter how you approach it, it's going to come down to holding the part by that short midsection to put in the final features. And when gripping a short section like this at the mouth of a collet, there's a tendency for the collet to distort as it closes down on the part, throwing it off center and giving a poor grip. But if a pin of the same diameter as the workpiece is inserted into the collet first, then the collet is supported at both ends, and so closes correctly, giving a strong and accurate grip. Following the precedent of the original mechanism, the upper section of the input arbor is to be squared off, with a degree or so of taper. The taper angle isn't super critical, so an easy way to get the result is to simply place a packing shim under one end of the work as it's machined. The shim is then removed to ensure that the subsequent pilot hole is formed square to the axis of the work. The hole is just large enough to permit entry with a small file, which was then used to expand the opening into a rectangular shape matching the shank of the cotter pin. Okay, so with the arbors complete, it's time to finish off the last components of the wheel assemblies, the ratchet wheel, cotter pin and washers. The washers are very straightforward to form, drilled, reamed and then parted off to the correct thickness. The cotter pin and ratchet, however, are a little more work, and are probably best completed as hand filing tasks. A custom cutter could certainly be made for the ratchet, but as a one-off, it's probably more work to go through that process than it is to simply get to work with the saw and some files. The raw stock that I've used for the ratchet is slightly thicker than required to simplify the stock requirements of the project. So I reduced it to final thickness with a facing cut on the lathe. The cotter pin is a key design element of the original mechanism and was deliberately shaped as a stylized representation of a horse head. One detail worth pointing out is that although I've specified a single dimension for the height of the cotter pin shank, it in fact needs to be formed with a very gentle taper so that it wedges into place when inserted into the input arbor. The last component to be made for the gear train assemblies is the Lunaphase date disc. The markings for the disc will be chemically etched in a later episode. So, for now, it's enough to bring the disc to size in preparation for a test fit. Okay, so that's everything required to put the assemblies together. They can now be given a dry test fit, just like the Zodiac assemblies in the previous episode, to check the clearances and confirm the wheel and pinion seatings are as they should be. And this is how I'll leave them for the time being, so that they can be easily pulled apart later in the build. Next up is the body of the mechanism and the dial plate. The original artifact was missing some key elements when it was purchased, but the research indicates that the main body of the device consisted of a circular plate fitted into a fabricated bowl, and that together they formed a sealed housing around the mechanism. Now there are a few different ways to tackle the construction of this bowl section, so I thought it might be worthwhile showing at least two methods, so that you can choose which one best suits your build of the project. The first method I'll show is direct fabrication. It's essentially how the original device was made, and it's the method that I used when I made the project prototype. The bowl is formed from a disc and a brass strip formed into a circular hoop. The two parts are then silver soldered together and finally trimmed to the correct dimension. The key to success with this approach is to maintain a small excess of material as a margin outside the required dimensions of the part. That excess will be trimmed away on the lathe, but there's not a whole lot of extra material to work with, so it certainly requires close attention to stay within the limits. The hoop needs to be bound fairly tightly to keep the ends together for soldering. And this also gives the part enough structure to permit a light cleanup cut on the lathe. The surfaces were then prepared with some flux and the parts bonded with silver solder. Now the reason for using silver solder in this instance is that it has a much higher melting point than soft solder. So this bond is sure to be preserved when other components are soft soldered into place later in the build. The part was then mounted on the lathe and trimmed down to its final dimensions. Okay, so that's one way to do it, and it's an approach that generally suits the tools found in the home machine shop. But you'll have noticed that there wasn't a whole lot of room for error. Even a small mistake in forming the band could easily have led to the part being scrapped. So here's a second method that I think plays it much safer, by using easily sourced brass to form a casting, from which the final part can then be machined. Wood is of course a common choice for making a casting pattern. But for a one-off like this, I decided to use a slab of high-density polyethylene. It is a little soft and certainly won't last long-term like wood, but it's a whole lot of fun to turn, and I love the way the chips fly off the tool, no matter how deep the cut. Next, I formed the sand mould using Petrobond moulding sand. The majority of the source metal was cast brass from old taps, which I've found to be excellent to work with. It machines well, and given that it's an alloy already formulated for casting, it also performs well during the melt and pour. The boss feature on the inside surface of the casting is the first holding point for machining. Gripping the part here permits full access to machine the base, as well as drilling of the central hole. As I mentioned in the previous video, a superglue arbor with a machinable center rod is a great way to relocate a part back onto a lathe axis in preparation for more machining. The central spigot and trued face act together as a register for the part, allowing it to be relocated on the lathe as many times as required to bring the part to final dimension. Often the surface of a casting is quite hard and has a small amount of casting sand embedded within. The sand performs much like a grinding wheel on high-speed steel and can quickly blunt the end of the tool so that it no longer cuts effectively. The outer rim of this casting is a good example, but a quick pass with insert tooling is an easy solution to the problem. Once the outer layer of the casting has been removed, high-speed steel can again be used for the finishing cuts. Now, the downside of the casting approach, of course, is that it requires access to foundry equipment that's not particularly common. But if you've been considering setting up a home foundry for yourself, then maybe this project is just the excuse you've been looking for to get started. Be sure to check out the Tools Glorious Tool series, episode number 3 for some ideas on setting up the furnace, and episode number 5 on constructing a pyrometer. In the next episode, I'll continue the project by depthing the wheel assemblies and fitting the dial plate. Thanks for watching. I'll see you later.